Boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Warwick Christmas Lectures. Please welcome on stage your scientist for this evening, Dr. John Halpin.
Hello, my name's John Halpin, and tonight I'm going to tell you about one of my favourite applications of physics, the physics of music. By the end of this lecture, you should know how to break glass with just your voice, how to break the sound barrier in your own home, and how to levitate objects with sound. Now, you might think that physics and music don't have much in common. They're very different subjects, aren't they? But by the end of this lecture, you should see the relationship between them, and you should understand how physics can go some way to explain why music sounds good. So before we can start on the physics of music, we need to understand what a sound is. Now, a sound is a vibration or a wobble that travels through a material, and it transfers energy between places. And to try and let you see what a sound wave looks like, I've got this machine here. So if Adam the cameraman can look along the rods. So there's wooden rods, and they're connected by elastic. And if I wobble the end, you can see a wave travels along the rods. Now, this is just like how a sound wave travels in air. Thanks, demonstrators. This is just like how a sound wave travels in air. In air, sound travels as what's called a longitudinal wave, and it's represented by this diagram here. So on the left, we've got a source of sound. This is something that's vibrating. So it could be the skin of a drum or, say, or your vocal cords, and it's compressing the air molecules. So you can see the air molecules bunched together, and they're travelling along from side to side. But they don't change, they stay in their original positions. They don't actually move along. So the energy is travelling as a vibration or a wobble. We can see that sound needs a medium to travel through. And you can't get sound to travel unless it's something for it to pass through. So what would happen if we took away the sound, the medium that the sound's travelling through? Well, to try and show you, my assistant's just bringing you a demonstration on. So we've got an airtight container here, and inside we've got a siren. Now we're going to start the siren, and we're going to pump out all the air using this, which is a vacuum pump. It's just like your vacuum at home, but a lot more powerful. And it's going to suck out all the air from the airtight container. Now, when the siren's sounding, what do you think is going to happen to the siren when all the air's removed? Could you put your hand up if when we remove all the air, that the sound of the siren's going to carry on? So hands up who thinks the sound of the siren's going to carry on when we take all the air out. I think some of you have seen this before, okay. And what's going to happen, can you put your hand up if you think the sound of the siren's going to stop when we pump all the air out? Oh, quite a few of you, okay. Well, let's see what happens. So if we can plug the vacuum pump in, and now we're going to start the siren. It's very loud, sorry guys. Okay, I'm going to put the lid on. And now if we can start the vacuum pump. So we're sucking the air out now, and can you hear the sound of the siren? I think it's there very faintly. I'll come to that in a minute. So it's a lot quieter than how it was when the air was still inside. So now we've taken away the medium that the sound's travelling through. We're struggling to hear the sound. So let's try letting the air back in now, and let's see what happens to the sound. Ah, so now you can hear it's got a lot louder. Now I've let the air back in. The reason you were still hearing it when we had a vacuum inside the airtight container, also if we can stop the siren now, the reason we were still hearing it was because the siren's actually sitting on some foam, and the sound's been transmitted through the foam out through the sides of the container. So sound can travel through materials other than air. So say when you're swimming in the swimming baths and the sound's travelling through water, so you can still hear the sound, can't you, when you're swimming along. It can also travel through things like wood or metal. The speed at which the sound travels through a material depends on the material's density and its elastic properties. So elastic properties are something to do with this. So this is very soft, okay? Sound travels fast through a very stiff and very light material, and it travels slowly through a very soft and a very heavy material. So to show you how sound travels in different materials, I've got two gas molecules that are just going to make their way onto the stage. This is Dr. Sani from the physics department. I've got two gas molecules. So I've got this yellow one here. Now, he's nice and light, and he's very springy. So this is a gas molecule in a material that's very, very light, and it's very springy. Now, I've got this one here. Now, I think he's eaten too many mince pies. He's heavy, he is. So this one, it's soft, and it's very heavy. Ooh, okay. And what I want to do is have two sound waves racing through these two different materials. So I think on this material, so on the heavy, soft gas molecule, it's going to be Dr. Sani from the physics department. Now, I need a volunteer from the audience. So if one of my assistants can come and pick somebody from the audience. Okay, what's your name?
Jack.
Jack, nice to meet you, Jack. So if you can come over here. So you're going to be racing on this guy here. So he's light and he's springy, okay? And you're going to race Dr. Sani. And I want you to race her all the way to the other side of the stage, okay? So when I count you down, you're going to race across. There's a prize if you win, okay, if you need an incentive. Okay, on your marks, get set, go. Come on, faster. Oh, you're in the lead now, go on, almost there. Oh no, come on, get back on. No cheating. Very good. Oh, well done. That's brilliant, it's fantastic. Right, we've got a prize for you over here, and if Dr. Sani can take them off stage. Thanks, Jack. So you can see that sound travels faster in lighter, more springy materials. So what about sound in a gas that's lighter than air? What about if we put sound and made it travel through helium? I mean, the molecules in helium are lighter than the nitrogen and oxygen molecules in air. So I'm going to have a choir come to the stage now, and the choir are going to sing you some Christmas carols while breathing helium. Can you give a round? Can you welcome our choir to the stage, please?
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. Let heaven and nature sing. Let heaven and nature sing. Let heaven and nature sing.
I'm with helium.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let heaven and nature sing. Let heaven and nature sing.
That was brilliant, choir. Thank you. Right, so you might have heard that their voices sound higher, but they still sounded in tune. So the notes they're singing aren't changing, but their voices sound more squeaky. We'll come to exactly why this is happening a bit later, but a simple explanation is there's lots of... Your voice makes lots of notes at the same time, lots of sound waves, and when you breathe helium, it emphasises the sound waves that sound higher and more squeaky. So we need some technical terms. We need some language to describe a sound wave rather than just saying it's more squeaky. So I'm going to try and explain some terms to you. So when you hear a sound wave, you're hearing a series of vibrations of the air reaching you. Now, the number of vibrations that are reaching you in a certain time is called a frequency. Now, this glass has a frequency, if I ping it, of 440 hertz. So, if I ping this glass, you're hearing 440 vibrations of the air reaching you every second. So another term we need is the sound waves wavelength. If we look at the bar along the top, so the black regions represent where the air is compressed. And if we measure the distance between one compression and the next compression, that's the sound waves wavelength. We can also measure it between any consecutive point on the wave. So you can measure it from here to here, or perhaps from there to there. That'd also be the wavelength and has the same distance. Finally, the last term is the sound's amplitude. So sounds with a large amplitude are very loud, and sound waves with a very small amplitude, they're very, very quiet. Understanding how sounds work as a wave can help us explain something that's called the Doppler effect. Now, even if you've never heard the name Doppler effect before, you've certainly heard it demonstrated. Now I've got two balls here, and inside them are buzzers, and they're foam balls, and I'm going to throw them at you. And what I want you to do when I start the buzzers is listen for how the pitch of the buzzer changes. Listen for how the frequency of the buzzer changes as the ball passes over you. If you catch one of them, can you just pass them to my assistants in the aisles, please, who will switch them off? Okay. So the first sponge is going to go over to the left corner. Now, if you're sitting in the middle of the audience or at the front, you're going to hear the pitch get higher as it travels towards you, and then lower as it flies over you and travels away. And if you're sitting right at the back, you're only going to hear it getting higher in pitch as it travels towards you. So let's start the first one. Okay, oh, we've got some good catches at the back. You ready? Well done, good catch there. So I hope you all listened to the pitch as it travelled over you. And let's get this one to this side. You ready? Arms up. Oh dear, sorry. Okay, so now you should have all heard the Doppler effect. We can understand how the Doppler effect works by looking at this animation on the screen. So if we look at this dot that's moving in the middle, we can think of that as our source of sound. Now you can see that the rings around it, they're the disturbances that it's making in the air. And if you're a listener on the right-hand side of the source of sound, so if the source of the sound's coming towards you, then each consecutive disturbance of the air has less distance to travel, so that they bunch up and you hear a higher-pitched sound. So if you're a listener and the source of the sound's coming towards you, the sound gets higher-pitched. And if you're a listener on the left-hand side, you can see the disturbances the source of sound is making. They have further to travel, and that this makes the frequency of the sound lower. But what would happen if this dot was going faster than the disturbance that it's creating? I mean, is that even possible? Do people think you can go faster than the speed of sound? Can you put your hand up if you think you can go faster than the speed of sound? Ooh, everyone, I think. Very good. So yes, you can go faster than the speed of sound. One of the most common examples is a fighter plane. So when a fighter plane breaks the sound barrier, you hear something called a sonic boom. It's very loud, it's just this big bang. The reason you hear it is because the sound waves or the disturbance of the air that the aircraft's creating can't escape from the path of the aircraft. So they bunch up, and this creates a shock wave. And this is what you hear as the sonic boom. Now, there is a way that you can break the sound barrier at home. I just need some props for this. So you need to have watched Indiana Jones. So this might take a few attempts. I'm only Indiana Jones in training. Okay, so the cracks you just heard are sonic booms. Very small ones, but they are sonic booms. The reason a whip can break the sound barrier, or a whip like this can break the sound barrier, is because when I crack it, I make a wiggle that starts at the bottom, and all the energy in that wiggle ends up concentrated right at the end at the tip here. And when all that energy is in the tip, it's travelling so fast that it's travelling faster than the speed of sound, which is 332 metres, thereabouts, in air. So let's kind of go away from the sound barrier now, and let's look at instruments, and let's find why instruments sound so good. And so if I get my wine glass, I want to explain something called resonance to you. So resonance is when something vibrates or oscillates at one frequency with preference over others. So if I ping this wine glass, so it's 440 hertz, this is the wine glass's resonant frequency. And it doesn't matter how I ping this wine glass or where I ping it, it still rings with the same frequency, which is known as its resonant frequency. And now if my assistants are going to bring some demonstrations on, I should be able to show you another example of resonance. So shortly they'll be bringing some tuning forks on, and thanks guys. So I've got two tuning forks. Both this tuning fork and this tuning fork have the same resonant frequency. So if I ping this tuning fork, you can hear it rings with the same frequency as this tuning fork. Now what I want to do is use that to transmit the vibrations from this tuning fork to this one. I'm going to ring this, which is going to vibrate the air. And because the air is vibrating at the resonant frequency of this tuning fork, it's going to set this vibrating. Now you'll know it's vibrating because this ping pong ball that's up on the screen now is going to start jumping, which should indicate that it's vibrating. So what I want you to do, I'm going to ring this, and I want you to watch the ping pong ball on the screen very closely. Okay, you watching? And again. So how far away would this work? Well, you can hear this right at the back of the lecture theatre, so it should work for quite a distance. So you might have heard that opera singers with very good voices can break wine glasses. And the reason they can do that is because of resonance. So if an opera singer can sing at a glass's resonant frequency, just like that tuning fork with the ping pong ball, they're able to set it vibrating. And they're able to set it vibrating so much that it'll actually smash. And I'd like to have a go at doing this tonight. Do we have any good singers in the audience? Oh. Oh, a few. You're not very confident. Okay, well, luckily, I've managed to persuade a real opera singer to join us tonight. Can I welcome Jo to the stage? Now, Jo is a mezzo-soprano opera singer, and she has a wonderful voice. Hi, Jo. So, can we hear your voice? Can we hear how good it is? That's fantastic. So opera singers are very good at hitting certain notes very accurately. So Jo, to break this wine glass, what I'd like you to do is you have to listen to the wine glass. And I want you to try and sing at that frequency. And we might have some safety specs for you, just in case you manage to smash it. I'm going to stand back, okay? Looking good, okay. So what I've done is I've put some bits of polystyrene inside the glass, if you can see them on the camera. And what will happen is if Jo manages to get near the resonant frequency of the glass and to sing very powerfully, you might see that the bits of polystyrene start to jump around. So Jo, I'll let you try. I saw them start to move there. Jo, that was a very good effort. Thank you. Can I have a round of applause for Jo, please? Thank you. So So I'd still kind of like to break my glass, really. Luckily, I've got Super Joe here. Super Joe is a very powerful loudspeaker. And into the speaker, I've got a sound generator, which should be able to make the same frequency sound which Joe was trying to sing. So the resonant frequency of the glass, which should break the glass. So what I'm going to do to start with is I'm going to find the resonant frequency of the glass, and then I'm going to turn it up, and then it should break. We'll know we're at the resonant frequency of the glass because the bits of foam inside will start to jump around. So if Adam, the cameraman, can look at the glass inside, and if he can focus on the bits of foam that are in there, and then I'll start to turn this up. See you then. And I'm going to slowly adjust the frequency, and I want you to watch the foam. Oh, I think that's close, isn't it? Yeah, there we go. Okay, so I think we're at the glass's resonant frequency. I'll just turn it down. Right, so this is going to be a little loud, so if you're easily scared, you might want to cover your ears, okay? Let's see if we can break it. So keep watching the glass on the screen. You ready? Oh, there we go. Okay, so we've smashed our glass. So in musical terms, generally when we're getting resonance, we're getting something called a standing wave. So really we need to understand these things called standing waves in order to understand instruments. So if Dr. Sani can come to the stage, she's going to help me make a standing wave. So this is a slinky, and it's a very good way to visualise a standing wave. Now, a standing wave is formed when a vibration travels through, or a pulse travels through a material, and it's reflected from a fixed end, in which case Dr. Sani, and it bounces back, and it interacts with the original vibration, and this forms a stationary wave. So what I'm going to do is vibrate this, and I want you to watch the shape the slinky makes. Let's have a go. Okay, so we've got a standing wave now. So you can see there's a part in the middle that's hardly moving at all, okay? That's called a node. And there's a bit near me and a bit near Dr. Sani that are vibrating a lot. They're called antinodes. Now what I should be able to do, if I vibrate this faster, then we should be able to see a standing wave, but this time with a shorter wavelength. So we've got a higher frequency, but now we're going to have a shorter wavelength, okay? So what's the shape of the slinky? Okay, so now we've got three antinodes and two nodes in the middle, but the wavelength's shorter and the frequency's higher. Thanks, Dr. Sani. It'd be nice to hear a standing wave, wouldn't it, to know what they sound like. So what I've got here is lots of lengths of pipe used. You've probably seen this in your bathroom. And if you hit the end, the sound that you're hearing is a standing wave in the pipe. And you hear for a short pipe, it's high, and for a long pipe, it's lower. So shorter, lower for a longer pipe. Unfortunately, I can't play this tonight. I'm not talented enough, but we've got lots of very talented people in the physics department. So if Dr. Burrows can come to the stage. So Dr. Burrows is very good at this, and I'm hoping she'll play it for us. So Dr. Burrows, what do you do when you're not playing this?
Well, I work in the brick glasses and ceramics, using them to make nuclear waste safe.
Wow, that's impressive. But you're not going to do that tonight, are you?
No. Nope.
But tonight you're going to give us a tune.
I am indeed.
So for an instrument, say like a violin or a guitar, the standing waves, they get a bit more complicated. So if you have a sort of a 2D object, you start to get more interesting standing waves formed. It'd be kind of cool to see what frequencies those standing waves are. One way we can do that is with something called fast Fourier transform. So what a fast Fourier transform does is the math behind it is very complicated, but it should be enough to quite easy to explain. So what we've got is a graph, and it's giving us frequency along the bottom and amplitude along here. Each peak on here represents one frequency. So if I make I've got a sound generator here, and I'm going to use it to make a sound. So I want you all to be very quiet so you don't interfere with the experiment. So let's run this now. Okay, so we can see that was just a sine wave I played you. So that's the simplest kind of wave that just goes like that. And you can see, apart from a little bit at the bottom, really, we've just got one main peak there. But what about something like a guitar? How would a guitar look on here? Because a guitar doesn't sound like that, does it? It's a lot nicer to listen to than that buzz you've just heard. So let's try a guitar. So I'm going to play you an A on the guitar, and I'm going to run the fast Fourier transform again. And I want you to watch how it looks. Okay, so we can see that now we've got a lot more going on. We've got lots of different peaks, and these are all different standing waves that are formed in the guitar. So the biggest one, it's called a fundamental frequency. So that's the frequency, the A, that I'm playing. It's 220 hertz. But then we've got all these as well. And that's what makes the guitar sound like a guitar. And it's what violin makers go to great lengths to achieve. What about, so hopefully some of you like rock music. How would it look if I distorted the guitar? So if it sounds more like that, how would it look? So I'm going to play the same note again. So this time you can see there's a lot more going on. And to me, this is why rock music sounds so good. Not perhaps to everyone's preference, but I think it sounds good. And this is one of the reasons why, because it's such a complex note. So there's a way we can visualise standing waves in a tube, and it's using one of these. This is called a Rubens tube, and my assistant Dave is going to help me demonstrate it to you. How a Rubens tube works is I've got a tube, and it's fixed at one end, and we're going to put some gas into the tube. Along the top of the tube is a burner, and at the other end there's a speaker. Now Dave's going to light the gas, and then he's going to start putting sound using the speaker into the Rubens tube. And that's going to set up a standing wave in the Rubens tube. So first of all, we're just going to put in some very simple sine waves. So that's a wave that just goes like that into the Rubens tube. We'll see how that looks. So he's going to go to a very high frequency and then slowly decrease the frequency. And I want you to watch when we've got a standing wave formed in the tube. So watch the flame on the screen, and just like the slinky, you should see parts that have a high amplitude and parts that have a low amplitude. That's our nodes and our anti-nodes. Okay, I think that's the standing wave there. So we've got the nodes and the anti-nodes there. But keep going, Dave, keep getting lower. So you can see that as the frequency gets lower, the wavelength, so the distance between here and here on the standing wave, gets longer. And another there. They get more dramatic as with a lower frequency. And keep going. Brilliant. Okay, I think that's the last one. So we'll stop the We'll stop the sound generator there. But very good, Dave. If we get, if we have a 2D object, such as a guitar body, there's actually quite a nice way that we can look at the standing waves formed in it. So what we're bringing on now is called Chladni plates, and it's a plate, and underneath it is a loudspeaker. On the plate we've got some table salt, and just like our Rubens tube, we've got a sound generator, and we're going to send in sounds to the loudspeaker. And if Dave can come back, I think he might start it running. So we're going to put different frequencies of sound into the loudspeaker, and it's going to vibrate the tray, and we'll get a standing wave formed on the tray. I want you to watch for patterns formed on the tray when we make standing waves in it. Now, there's going to be regions of the standing wave that have a very big amplitude, and that they're going to shake the salt off, and there's going to be other regions that aren't vibrating much at all, so the salt's probably going to collect there. So when we're ready, we'll start putting in frequencies. So I want you to watch for patterns. Okay, I think that's our first. You see, it's very symmetric. And we'll keep going. So as the frequency gets higher, the patterns become more intricate. There's a lot more going on in the pattern. You see that these patterns have a lot more features than the earlier patterns. If we were to use a different shape of plate, for instance, if we use a circular pattern, then we get different patterns formed. Very good, Dave. Thank you. So because it's Christmas and it's a season for giving, I kind of wanted to give you all of you something. Unfortunately, I couldn't afford a guitar for each of you, so we've made you these. These are drinking straw pan pipes, and we're going to talk you through playing Jingle Bells on them. But I'm going to get some help from my friends to do this, who are going to come on stage soon. So you want to hold your pan pipes, as is illustrated in the slide. So you want to hold the longest pan pipe on the left and the shortest pan pipe on the right. The longest pan pipe is number one. So for any number ones in here, you want to play the longest pan pipe. And for the shortest pan pipe, you want to play, or for five, you want to play the shortest pan pipe. To get a good sound out of them, you don't want to be blowing down the pipe. You just want to be blowing over the top of the pipe. So just have a practice for a minute and try and play all the notes individually. Okay, so I think my volunteers have all got pan pipes now. Okay, I think you're all very good now. I think you're ready to play. Okay, so if everyone can just give their pan pipes a rest for a second. I know they're a lot of fun. And what we're going to do, we're going to play the first couple of lines of Jingle Bells for you, which should be on the screen in a sec. So if you could have the notes back on. So we're going to play these lines for you, and Dr. Burrows is going to lead us through playing Jingle Bells. But just so you know the tune, I want you to listen to us first, and then you can join in. So when you're ready, Dr. Burrows. Okay. So we're going to go quite slowly for you, but I want you all to try and join in with us this time. So when you're ready, Dr. Burrows?
3, 4.
Very good. I think you should give yourselves a round of applause. That sounded great up here. There's lots of red faces from all that puffing. So hard work. I think we should have one more try at that. I think, yeah. Okay, when you're ready, Dr. Burrows. Brilliant, thank you, thanks very much. Okay, so you can take these home with you. You've obviously had a lot of fun with them. No expense spared. So I'd like to test all of your hearing now, to actually know what kind of frequencies that you can hear. So the human hearing range is commonly given from about 20,000 hertz to 20 hertz, but it varies from person to person. What I'm going to do is I'm going to use my sound generator, and I'm going to make a sound, but it's going to start off with a very high frequency. Now, if you're young, you're probably going to hear this. Well, we can hear that already, can't you? There you go, okay. Right, if you're young, you'll probably hear the sound before the elder people in the audience, okay? And if you do hear the sound first, I want you to raise your hand. Now, I've got some sweets here, and I'll try and throw some sweets in the direction of the first hand. I've still got the ball whip, if you keep that up. Okay, so he's knee quiet now, so it'll be just on the absolute limit of your hearing, and hopefully it'll be someone young that wins this. So let's have a go. Any hands up yet? Oh, could I have the house lights, please? Oh, that's me talking, you can hear. could I have the house lights up, please, so I can see people? Oh, a few of you. Oh, I think it might just be because you're the only one I can see. You picked a good place to sit. I think it's the young people at the front. It's all the children, isn't it? Well done. I can't hear this. I can see lots of very distinguished grey-haired people with their hands down. I still can't hear this. Oh, there we go. Yeah, I can hear it now. Oh, some of you still got your hands down. Okay. Can you get it now? I'm sorry, that's awful, isn't it? Put your fingers in your ears. Good idea. Keep going. Oh, everyone now. Brilliant. Very good. Okay, I'm going to stop there before I give you all headaches. Brilliant. Okay, so some sweets for the... sorry, okay, I'll split them. There you go. Compromise. Very good. okay, so what you were hearing there, what you weren't hearing there, so the very, very high frequency part, that's going into what's called ultrasound. And there's lots of applications of ultrasound. The one that you probably, the common application of ultrasound is medical imaging. But what I'm going to do tonight for you is something called acoustic levitation. And if I come over here, I've got this is a transducer. It's an ultrasonic speaker. And on top of it is a plate. And I'm going to make a standing wave between the speaker or the transducer and the plate. Now, in a standing wave, you've got regions of high pressure and regions of low pressure. And I'm going to try and float a tiny polystyrene bead. So I'm just going to show my polystyrene bead to the camera. See, there it is. So you'll have to have good eyes to see it. I'm going to try and float this on top of the ultrasonic transducer. So let's see if this will work. You'll have to be patient with me here. It takes a few goes. I'm just going to get my beads ready. OK, Okay, so I'm going to start the transducer. Some of you actually might be able to hear this. So it's just above the human hearing range. So some of you young people might actually hear my experiment. So what I can do is I can actually stack the beads up in the standing wave. So you know a standing wave's got lots of nodes and lots of antinodes, so I can stack the beads in the nodes and the antinodes. I should be able to keep going. There you go. Put some more in. Ooh, I've got two stuck together there. This is used a lot in industry to move very tiny, delicate components around without touching them. So I'll stop that now. Thank you. So I think that might be it for tonight. I think that's all my demonstrations. Well, I'm kind of hoping you might be able to help me with something. So my friend Ollie from the physics department, he's got a problem. He's a drummer, and his neighbours have been complaining about his drumming. He's very loud, you see, and that they can hear him at night, and it's annoying them. Ollie, can we hear you drumming? Can we hear how loud it is? That's loud. I wouldn't want you leaving me above me. So, being physicists, we like to solve problems using physics. We had the idea that, well, you saw our siren. That was about as loud as Ollie. You saw our siren earlier in the airtight container. And we stopped the sound of the siren by taking the air away, didn't we? And yeah, so if we put Ollie in an airtight container and we take the air away, then Ollie can play happily inside with no air. Yeah, Ollie? Yeah. With no air, and we won't be able to hear his drumming, which is great. So we've made him, I think it's on its way, a giant airtight container. And we're going to put Ollie inside the airtight container. Now, we need our vacuum pump back again. So the vacuum pump's going to suck all the air out from Ollie's airtight container. You okay there, Ollie? Yep. Can we have a drum roll as you go in? Very good. I think we need a lid for our container. Stop the air getting in. And put the lid on so it's nice and airtight now. No air can get in. And we just need the vacuum pump. So if I put that, there you go. Okay, vacuum pump's connected. So I'm going to start the vacuum pump, and well, the sound of Ollie's going to stop. The sound of Ollie will stop. Nothing wrong there, and it'll happily drum inside with no air. I want you to just let me know if anything's going wrong. Okay, just shout out if you know something's amiss. So I'm going to start the vacuum pump. Ollie, can we hear you drumming? Okay, Ollie, I'm starting the vacuum pump now. Okay, well, thank you all for coming tonight. I hope you've enjoyed it. Oh, the drums sound strange, don't they? They're a lot quieter now. I think that's better. I can't hear them anymore. Yeah, I definitely can't hear them anymore. That's really good. Yep. Yeah, it stopped. Oh. Yeah, I'm sure he's having a great time in there. So if I could go back to my slides, please. Oh, he's enjoying himself. He really likes his drums. So if you've enjoyed tonight and you kind of want to learn more physics, we're doing another lecture. It's given by myself and Dr. Rachel Edwards, who you might know from Christmas lectures past, and it's called Material Circus. It's all about material science. That's on February the 11th. We're going to be giving leaflets outside, so as you leave the lecture tonight, pick up a leaflet. I'd also like to say that we'll be taking the demonstrations, including this, outside, where you can play with them afterwards. And I hope you've had a good night. Thank you.